Can we would start the session now? Thank you.
Shall I?
Yeah.
That's fun. Hello, welcome to the last session. Thank you for sticking around. I think that TUAC has saved the best to last here with this panel. We've got some really interesting speakers. We're talking about the platforms, the labor platforms, which obviously we've touched on in various places during the day, particularly with that last session talking about Uber. But obviously there's much more to the platform economy than just Uber. There's a whole other set of platforms that are sometimes called the human cloud platforms, where service sector labor has been sort of globalized and broken down into small tasks. This obviously poses huge challenges and questions for the trade union movement. And what's great about our panel is that I think they all have really granular knowledge of what is going on and also what trade unions are practically doing now to try and get involved with this and direct it in a more progressive way. So I'll introduce them very quickly. So we have, to my left, Pascal Pavageau. He's the Confederal Secretary from FO. Then we have Sik Silberman. He's from IG Metall, and he's also one of the founders of Turkopticon, which you'll hear more about. Saadia, Zahidi is the Senior Director and Head of Gender Parity and Human Capital at the WEF, the World Economic Forum. We have Jan Trahakopuil. I did that very badly, Jan. I practiced that. He's a senior researcher at the ETUI. And we also have Frederick Sodekvist, who's an economist at UnionN. So we will begin with Valerio De Stefano, who's one of the experts on this whole phenomenon of the platform economy and its implications for labor law. He's going to give us a quick presentation so that we can understand what we're talking about and what the big issues are. So over to you, Valerio.
Yeah. Okay. First of all, thank you very much for having me here today. I will try to be very, very quick to leave it to the other panelists. But just to start trying to understand what this gig economy, platform economy, these buzzwords that go around and we hear all the time, try to understand what we are talking about. Normally, we mean by that two main forms of work. Crowd employment, which is work that is executed online. It can be executed from any place in the world on platforms that post jobs. There can be very small, micro tasks or much more meaningful and bigger works. And we are what we call work on demand by apps, so work for companies that actually mobilize workers in the real world, material world, like Uber, Lyft, TaskRabbit, and all that. And of course, there are many, many differences between these two forms of work. One is virtual and one is not, and this is also pretty relevant for the kind of regulation you can imagine and the kind of and the way the work is executed. But of course, also within these two categories, there are so many differences that it's very hard to come up with a meaningful global definition. Most of the time we hear about work in the gig economy, but actually work in the gig economy is very various, it's very multifaceted. It has not just one dimension. So we should be attentive to that also when we try to devise a policy solution. But having said that, there are some commonalities between these two forms of work. The first of all is that it allows for a very easy and quick matching of supply and demand of work and reduce transaction costs between platforms, workers, and customers. It's pretty much customer-oriented, affords for a lot of flexibility to platforms and businesses that use these services. And from the worker side, it can create job opportunities with flexible schedules. So basically, you are allowed to go in and out of the platforms with no obligation to be there. But there also are some risks that come from the pay-as-you-go nature of the work that's on the platform. So basically, the work is paid only for the very time in which the work is executed, and all the slack phases are not paid to the worker. The phase of looking for work is also not paid. So there's a lot of risk that has been that is being shed from companies, from platforms to workers. And I think that these two quotes from two of the main operators on the gig economy are pretty much self-explanatory. So Jeff Bezos, the founder of Amazon, talks of access to human as a service. Now, of course, when we hear about that, there are some risks. The first risk is that people are not even perceived as working on those platforms most of the time. We talk about services, tasks, rights, gigs, micro-businesses. Normally the word work, labor, worker is never utilized. And this has some meaningful consequences also on the way we perceive the work it's executed on that. It's like you really need to advocate for this work to be recognized as such. Most of the time, the flexibility is pretty limited from the worker's side, because it's true that you have no obligation of show up in the platform, and you can log in and out more or less as you want. But if you want to work, you need to be on the platform at very specific times, because the works, the jobs are posted or are around at specific times of the day. And particularly if you work, for instance, from India, as many crowd workers do, for jobs that are posted in the US, that also means that you need to work at night or at very unsocial hours. So the flexibility on the worker side is a bit reduced. And there's the risk of an increase in the casualization of the workforce, of this pay-as-you-go model, in which only the actual times of work are paid. And also a risk of growing informalization. When we've done a survey among crowd workers in two of the main crowd work platforms, the Amazon Mechanical Turk and Crowdflower, only 10% of people reported to be contributing in any form to any form of social security. So we also have a risk of increasing informalization. At the ILO, we started to work on the gig economy, on the platform economy, when we started to look more generally in the on the issue of non-standard employment. We came out very recently with a big report that's over here and it's accessible on the net for free. It's good to advertise ILO jobs, ILO works here at the OECD. Sorry for that. Basically, we started to look into this gig economy thing because we thought that there are many dimensions in the gig economy that are common also to many other non-standard forms of employment. Of course, it's jobs that is temporary. It's a commonality with casual work and temporary work and fixed work in general, and with some forms of marginal part-times and casual work. It has commonalities with temporary agency work and multi-party employment arrangements because the platform per se operates as a sort of triangularization. And within the platforms, we also have intermediaries. So there are companies that are specialized, for instance, on posting the jobs for someone else on the platform because posting the jobs might be complicated. So we have also this dimension of triangularization. And of course, there's also the issue of disguised employment and dependent self-employment. So the issue of the classification of the workers on the platform. So one of our key messages is that actually the gig economy per se is not a sector, is not a unique way of working. It's a pretty dishomogeneous one. And we shouldn't pigeonhole all these forms of work into one category, but actually we should look at broader dimensions on the labor market and examine the gig economy through the prism of other non-standard forms of employment. I'll go very quick here. And I will go, we skip a bit of legal slides that are, of course, boring because they are legal. what are some of the bigger risks in the gig economy? We have a risk for workers concerning all the fundamental principles and rights of work defined by the ILO. We have risk of freedom of association and collective bargaining. It's very difficult for these workers to get together and unionize. And even when they do that, even when they manage to do that, there might be regulatory obstacles to unionizing, because going together and forming a union between self-employed people might amount to a violation of antitrust law and price fixing. There's the issue of forced labor. In some places in the world, virtual workers actually work from labor camps. The same might be happening also with regard to child labor. So when we talk about online work, we don't think of this very traditional way of exploiting workers, but actually they could be out there. There could be sweatshops that exploit, and actually we found that there are sweatshops that exploit virtual work. There's an issue of discrimination, which has been reported in many cases in many many platforms in the gig economy. And again, in some cases, self-employed workers do not have access to the protection against discrimination at the workplace. So there's again a regulatory gap in that. Other common risks, of course, is the illusion of minimum wage. If you classify person as self-employed people, they don't have access to minimum wage. There's an issue of wage theft. In some platforms, you can work and deliver your work, and the platform and the client can retain your work and refusing to pay because the terms and conditions of the platforms allow for it. So there's a lot of risk of wage theft, and many workers report that they have been refused to be paid unreasonably. Also, there's a risk coming out of unilateral changes in the policy that can occur instantaneously. So basically, if you drive somebody to one place to another, the platform may decide to cut and to operate sales. So you basically you see your compensation cut once you already have delivered your job. There's of course a strong possibility of monitoring workers through online mechanism using the GPS, for instance. You control where people go, but also from virtual work there are platforms that take screenshots of workers' screens without them knowing to show the client that they are actually working when they are billing the client. So there's a strong possibility of monitoring using technology, and of course there's also the possibility of deactivating the worker, so excluding the worker from the platform, firing somebody with basically just by excluding the possibility for him to log into the platform. I'm almost concluding. Some of the questions that we have been analyzing and that come out of the general debate is, do we need specific categories of employment, and do we need specific set of regulation to deal with the gig economy? For the moment, I think we are still not in the position to say that we can create categories specific for this kind of phenomenon, because the phenomenon is so multifaceted that it will be very, very difficult even to define it from the regulatory perspective. You can't adopt one-size-fits-all policies on that, because there are some workers in the platforms that are genuinely self-employed and other workers that might be misclassified as employees, and trying to find new categories might just add confusion. And also, when these categories have been created in the past, and some sort of intermediate categories between employee and self-employed, the results have not always been good. There has been the categories of parasubordinati in Italy that's created a lot of tensions and a lot of exclusion of workers from protection and unclarity in the labor market. The UK workers, basically, is the worker in the UK is an intermediate category between self-employed and employees. And actually, there has been an interesting analysis of from Benjamin Sachs from Harvard that examined the Uber judgment, the famous Uber judgment that said that drivers of Uber in the UK are workers or are in this intermediate category. And in the US, since there's no intermediate category, they will be classified right away in the employment category using the same criteria that the UK court found. So if you introduce this category, there is maybe that you cluster some people in an intermediate category, even when they would have access to the world set of a regulation. There are, anyway, some possibilities to consider regulation specific for these forms of job. I will be very cautious on the idea of creating safe harbors. What does it mean? To create some thresholds, some monetary thresholds, below which you wouldn't apply employment and labor law, because many workers work on different platforms, and the risk is that they will be cut out from the platform before reaching the threshold. So you will basically add unprotected jobs to unprotected jobs to unprotected jobs. So move from one platform to another without reaching the platform because you are cut just before reaching the threshold. Possible ideas for the way forward are the extension of fundamental rights to all workers. So you don't need to be an employee to be covered by fundamental human rights, such as the right to freedom of association and collective bargaining, and the right not to be discriminated at your workplace. This shouldn't be a question of employment status. An expansion of social protection coverage also to cover self-employed people could also be examined. Some abusive clauses and termination policies could be revised. And this last point, I think, is one that we should really look into. Ensure portability of ratings. One of the biggest capital of workers in the gig economy is the rating, the reviews that they receive from every of their customer all the time. And having a good rating also allows you to access to better jobs on the platform. Now, if you move from one platform to another, you are not able to bring your rating with you, because the rating for the moment is considered to be proprietary of the platform. And this can create lock-in effect, because I am a very good driver on one platform, I am a five-star driver on one platform, but I can't move this good rating in other platforms. So I will be stuck into the one I start working in. And if I don't like it anymore, I couldn't go away bringing my capital with me. Now, we can't have the best of the two worlds here, and neither workers nor platforms can do that. But if we assume that workers on platform are self-employed workers, then the ratings should be owned by the workers. It shouldn't be owned by the platforms. If the platform say that they just act as a marketplace, that it makes no sense to say that the ratings belong to them. Then it belongs to the self-employed workers. Then if we assume that workers are employees, then we can discuss that the rating are proprietary of the platform. But I think the other way around is not possible. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Valerio. That was an excellent overview of a fascinating area. Now, Pascal, let's start with you, and let's get into how this is all playing out on the ground. Obviously, France is one of the many countries that has seen street protests over Uber and other platforms. How is your union dealing with this? How have you been tackling the rise of the platform in France?
Well, on behalf of Force Ouvrière, I should like to thank TUAC for this forum, and overall, I would like to thank TUAC for tackling this issue. It's been the case for a few months or even years. I think this is key and really indispensable, and based on what we've heard over the past 2 days, I mean, this is quite obvious. Now, the question is on the development of these platforms. And now, if you're talking about the technological development of these platforms, I mean, the technological development is unavoidable. Of course, I mean, the representative of the French government that came earlier talked about the French tech in French, and everyone was very concerned about that, but there's not much behind that, rest assured. But the question of innovation and digital technology is unavoidable. And we, as trade unions, in the past, including the previous industrial revolutions in order to make the work of wage earners less hard or to improve working conditions, we sometimes claimed developments, innovations, which could improve, help improve the working conditions of workers. So this issue of innovation, technology is unavoidable, like I said, and sometimes it can be a plus even. Now, the question of transforming or changing the qualifications or the jobs linked to new technologies is another issue that can be managed. It can be managed based on information or thanks to information. So this is not the issue, really. The issue, as Valerio just said, is the usage as a pretext to change the very nature of the jobs and of the collective and regulatory rights of workers. This is the grey area that we all know, this grey area meaning that you're not self-employed, not really, and at the same time you're not really a wage earner or an employee. We had the case in Ireland. Well, there is a case pending in Ireland where they are institutionalizing this grey area work where you are dependent or independent but at the same time economically dependent. We believe that this violates the Convention 98 of the ILO, and this is what we said. Now, in France, you might have followed our news, and we were very much against this recent labor law, loi travail. We fought against that for the past. We've been fighting against it for the past 6 months. And one of the elements we were against was the implementation of a third status, stemming from that gray area between independent workers and employees. I'd like to recall that in France, 93% of workers are covered by a collective bargaining or have a special status. This is the highest level in the world, actually. And this certainly shows that this new gray area certainly wants to devitalize collective bargaining, which is materialized by convention bargaining agreements, collective bargaining agreements. Now, the state of California was right in re-qualifying Uber workers as employees of Uber. We would say that they were wage earners in France, employees of Uber, because the social reality and economic reality of these employees is that they are truly employees. This is a study that we carried out. I'm still talking about Uber because this is really emblematic and very telling. Everyone has talked about it so far. And in France, if you are a wage earner, if you're an employee of a transport company, for instance, that is connected to Uber, then it doesn't make any difference in terms of your status. I mean, you're still paid for working 35 hours a week. You have minimum wages, and your employer has to pay taxes, and whether your employer is actually connected to the platform, technologically speaking, or not. So this is just a choice that is up to the company. But whether you're connected or not, you still have the regulatory rights linked to the overall framework governing your rights as an employee. Now, Uber is doing exactly the same work, or the Uber driver is doing exactly the same work as the driver who is an employee. But the driver who is an employee, we know that he has a driver's license, for once, which is better for a driver. We know that he does have his license. And the Uber worker, no one actually knows whether he does. Nobody can check on that. We don't even know whether these guys have a driver's license. And there is no working contract. The guy is connected and becomes a Uber worker just by clicking on a button. And on average, based on French data, he works 50 to 70 hours a week.
Jour, nuit, week.
And that could be during the daytime, during the nighttime, irrespective, so as to receive under 900 euros. So he's considered poor, according to the ILO's definition. And yet, he will have worked a working week that is twice as long as the legal working week. But that's not all. That is not all. Nobody will have paid the slightest social security contribution for unemployment benefits, for pension rights, for health. The economic and social reality of Uber worker, this worker of the grey area, is what I've described. And we, from amongst the trade unions, are very much against this. We're going to fight this. So we hope that the Uber people will join unions and so that they can be given the status of wage earners of employees. And I think this is going to be one of our major battles as a trade union. We want to prevent this grey area becoming institutionalized because it's in no way associated with any of worker rights. It's just offers unending flexibility. Right, I'm running over my speaking time a little bit, but this is something that's really important for us in France. You know, we're going to be having elections in just 2 months. So all the discussions are highly politicized. And if we look at the electoral programs of the presidential candidates, this whole issue of the gray area status is going to be in the headlines as soon as the presidential elections are over. Now, this what is known as the sharing economy, but it's not a sharing economy. From our point of view, it's an economy of slavery. We think that, in fact, it goes hand in hand with the return of a basic universal income. Now, the basic universal income is not a political initiative linked to the presidential elections. It's something that is a result of an increasingly Uberized society. Because you cannot simply survive working a 70-hour week with no social security contributions and earning 900 euros a week. The Romans knew that if the rowers, their slaves, were to get the boats going, then there was no point putting corpses on the benches. And so they had to be kept alive. Hence, the government is suggesting an additional €300 or so, which will bring them up to a sort of a survival income to complement the famous €900 earned from working 70 or more hours. So this measure, I think, in fact, goes hand in hand with these new economic business models, which for us are tantamount to slavery. We are very much in favor of converting and giving a proper status to these people. We want to protect workers' rights against this new form of economic development where each person has to fight their own battle and is an island unto themselves. And that, I think, brings us back to the whole question of the role of trade unions. And FO, my union, is delighted that we can encourage members who are not necessarily, who don't necessarily have the status of an employee. So that's the first measure that we're going to be promoting.
Thank you very much for that impassioned talk, and very interesting to get into the issue of universal basic income, which I hope that we'll discuss more. Let's crack on now, and I just want to ask Six to tell us a little bit about what work he's doing with IG Metall with regards to trying to provide some sort of platform for the platform workers. It's called faircrowdwork.org. Can you tell us a bit more about it, why you created it, whether it works?
How much time do you have?
5 minutes-ish.
Okay. This on? Yeah. So faircrowdwork.org, which you can go and look at right now, it's on the internet. It's sort of a prototype or alpha status in the next 4 to 8 weeks. We're hoping to have it a little bit more polished. It'll be a second version. The basic idea is to have, if you're familiar with TripAdvisor or Yelp, it's simply to have a TripAdvisor or Yelp, a sort of rating system, where workers can rate the platforms that they work on. And there's an overall rating, and then there's sort of various sub-ratings, like how good is the pay, how good is the technology, if you are evaluated as a worker, are the evaluations fair, are the consequences fair, can you contest unfair evaluations, what are some other, and so on. So, actually my boss put the first version on the internet a year and a half ago, and there was a lot of positive interest from other trade unions and journalists, not a lot of response from workers immediately, and so now we're going through the process of making the ratings a little bit more empirically validated and getting feedback from workers.
And do you think that that's enough, or is that just a step along the road? How do you feel about the bigger questions that Pascal was raising about whether these people should even be classed as self-employed?
No, it's absolutely not enough. It's one very small informational service that can be sort of maybe usefully centralized in our tall building in Frankfurt, but and sort of one node on the internet. But I don't think having a platform or having a blog with an extra 10 fields in the database with information about the various platforms and various workers' experiences and opinions about how the platforms work and if they're fair or not fair and what the different wages are in different countries under different legal regimes, I don't think that substitutes at all in any way for the various kinds of work that trade unions and policymakers have been doing historically and in previous employment conditions or have been talking about all day today.
Okay, thank you, Six. Right, we'll move on to Saadia. Could you tell us a little bit about the kind of the big picture here on the global effects that you think these platforms might have on the shape of employment and specifically maybe the gender implications, which was a question that was raised earlier in the day?
Thank you. So I feel I'm slightly on the wrong panel because of the starting point that we're taking at the World Economic Forum, which is very, very macro. About 9 months ago, we pulled all of our satellite departments on education, employment, and gender all together. So the new unit is taking a systemic approach towards education, gender, and work. And our starting point is that, yes, there are jobs that are disappearing. Some of our research that came out 1 year ago at Davos, exactly a year ago, beginning of 2016, was looking at what some of those effects would be. And according to our Future of Jobs report, there are about 5 million job losses predicted overall. 7 million job losses predicted, 2 million gains predicted from the 300 largest organizations in 15 big economies in 9 big industry sectors, compared to the 1.6 billion people that are working in the economies that we were covering. These are very small numbers. So at least in 2016, looking through to 2020, a lot of these employers were predicting, yes, losses overall, but not as large in comparison to the overall size of those workforces as we were expecting. The second piece is, of course, the change that is happening within existing job categories, the ones that are not being disrupted. And that is where a lot of the employers that answered our surveys said that about 35% on average of the core skills in existing jobs that are not expected to be disrupted will be completely different in 2020. So imagine a job in which just in 3 years' time, you're going to have a completely different skill set. Partly, that is being accelerated by the rise of these platforms, because it's becoming easier and easier to unbundle work and hand it off to one of these platforms. And then the third piece is there are also a lot of new job opportunities. At the same time as all of these statistics, you also have statistics that say that 40% of employers have job, the same very large employers across these large developed and emerging markets are finding it extremely hard to find the right talent that they're looking for. And so you've got this paradox happening at the same time, and it is going to require, of course, a lot of very specific solutions of the type that, you know, Fair Crowd Work is going to offer and a number of other initiatives, but it's also going to require a lot of larger sort of almost macro solutions, and that's partly what we're working on at the forum now. So our latest work on realizing human potential in the fourth industrial revolution calls for that new social safety net, calls for measuring these forms of work, whether those get placed into very different categories or whether, but we need to be able to track them, because if we're not able to track that change, it's going to be very hard to be able to understand where to head. A third piece is, of course, much more proactive employment services. Their geography around some of this offers, again, both opportunities and challenges, but at the moment, those look very much like challenges, and I think we've seen the political consequences of that as well. So those are three of the areas that we're proposing looking at. And then the one which we are working on most actively for the coming year is how do you reskill? So I think, again, at Davos this year, so just about a month ago, we had a very different situation from 1 year ago. If the business community 1 year ago was really concerned about what happens to the future of education, looking at today's children, I think today there's a realization that we need to be focusing on the 3 billion plus people that are already in the world's workforce, that are not going to go back to foundational education systems, and where you're going to need to put very different adult retraining and skilling systems in place. But looking at what the earlier speaker today said, you know, what would the truck driver want to reskill to versus what does the public policy or businesses would want to reskill that person to? And what we're going to try to do over the coming year is produce some work on what the jobs of the future are and some work on what reskilling maps would look like. How long would you need to retrain to jump from one category to another, and what is realistic around it? But some of this work is still very early days, which is why I was suggesting I might be on the wrong panel. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you very much. And actually, that education question taps in quite well to the platform question, because in a world in which employers increasingly scatter work into the cloud, into the internet, and have just people who are independent, self-employed taskers doing it, then who is providing the on-the-job training? Most adult education actually happens in the workplace, but if there are no employers supplying training to employees, then it raises a much bigger question about who on earth does train people. Right, let's move on to Jan. The ETUI has done a lot of work on this topic. Can you just fill us in a bit on some of your findings, and particularly around whether anyone is earning a fair wage on these platforms?
Well, it's difficult to add sort of more points, and maybe we don't even want to add more to the rather comprehensive picture we are getting, particularly from Valerio's presentation. But so what do we know about income on platforms? And I'm speaking from the sort of European perspective, which is what I'm looking at mostly in my time at work. Well, the overall picture seems to be of the platform economy being part of the sort of precarization of work. But the data we have on the sort of wages on platforms, we see the sort of the platform workers being mainly sort of, you can find all categories of workers there, but large bias towards sort of low income workers. We don't have very good data on sort of per hour remuneration. Some of that we have is secret, and I can't tell. But what I can say, I'm permitted to, is from that German data, is that well, 80% of workers don't sort of reach the local minimum wage on those who work on platforms in Germany. And sort of for the evidence we have from other countries, some seems to correspond to that overall picture of the large majority of workers who work through platforms don't reach sort of local minimum wage. If you look at the overall distribution of income on platforms, it's very skewed. We have a minority of workers earning, which seems quite decent amounts of money, but the large majority of them not earning that much. Now, they're often told, also in Brussels, discussion with Commission, well, this is not a big deal because, well, first, we don't know much about this phenomenon, and we can't see it in the, for instance, in the self-employment statistics at all. And it's true that if you look at the self-employment data in most countries in Europe, with exceptions like the UK, self-employment has been quite stable in recent years. And in countries like the UK, what seems to be driving that actually is not just the platform economy, but also the sort of high income services. So we can't see that. And indeed, the data that we have is that most people who use platforms use them to top up their income, often sort of as a sort of top up income to other types of work. Typically, it's a set of other type of sort of precarious employment that they have. But I think two points are important there. Even if we, you know, the data suggests that maybe like 3% of workforce in many countries, in other countries it's maybe even 10% that sort of earn substantial, that sort of depend on platforms for living in terms of the earning, let's say, more than 50% of income on platforms. Even, you know, if it's a small sort of minority, it's a sort of significant number of people that we are talking about. It's more than a million, definitely in Europe. And the second point in this context is that even this, you know, if majority of people who participate in this segment of the economy, if they just sort of enter, these are the students who just enter to do sort of occasional gig. If we have a sort of large enough number of people doing that, and this will put pressure on other people working in these sectors who may depend on that income as a sort of main source of income. And it's particularly a problem if these workers who enter through platforms benefit from some sort of unfair advantage in terms of not paying taxes or not having to comply to the regulation that others have to follow. Right, do I have time to say something? Or should I stop? No, okay.
Okay, thank you, Jan. I appreciate that. Sorry to cut you off, but we started a bit late and we have to finish on time. But that's a very sobering and interesting statistic that I haven't heard before, that 80% of the workers that you've studied don't reach the local minimum wage. And that takes us on very neatly to Frederick, because the question I wanted to ask you was about the Frankfurt paper on platform-based work, which your union is a co-signatory to. And this calls for a binding public commitment to ensure that tasks pay the minimum wage in wherever the worker's jurisdiction is. Can you tell us a bit more about that initiative and how successful it might be?
Well, I should start by adding that there's a piece of the sentence missing there, which we always add to international papers signed whenever there are Nordic unions present, which I always copy-paste from another document to get it right, because I'm not a lawyer. But that is, or the traditions on and social partner relationship existing in the country. I'm looking at Samuel, who is a lawyer. I probably said it wrong. But the reason for that is we don't have a minimum wage in Sweden, and in none of the Nordic countries we do have a legislated minimum wage. And the reason for this is that in Sweden, at least, 90% of the labor market is regulated by collective agreements. So 90% of the workforce have a collective agreement in place. And the reason this works is, well, it's the Nordic labor market model. For though I'm sure most of you have heard so much about this at trade union meetings before. And this means that the labor market in Sweden is self-regulated to a very high degree. So all these regulatory challenges that have been presented today, and I won't go into detail with it, but which we aim to solve in the coming years, they're up to us. We are not supposed to or want to go to the legislators to solve this. We want to work this out with the platform firms themselves. So looking at this from an economist perspective, like how should we do this? I should say we launched a report in November, which we have an idea, which I will briefly get into now, in how this can be done within the Swedish and Nordic context. But what we have to separate here, and we've touched upon this before, we've talked about regulatory arbitrage. And what we have to look at in the platform economy is there something innovative in this? And there most certainly is. But you can divide it into two categories. You can look at institutional innovation, which is, you know, how innovative are labor practices of the 19th century. But nonetheless, if you look at the institutional economics literature, it's called institutional innovation. Anyways, but there's also a technical aspect of this, technical innovation. And I mean, there's a reason these platforms are very popular. It's very easy to use it. And parts of actually, and I think the biggest innovative aspect of this is that parts of being an employer are actually being automated through the platform. The labor being, I mean, you're matching supply and demand in a way, and everything is done digitally. So you're basically digitalizing the role of the employer, or the marketplace for that matter, because maybe not all cases platform providers should be classified as employees. Maybe in most cases today, but we don't know where we will be in 5 to 10 years. So you look at this, I mean, I looked at this question from the Swedish perspective, and I see the Swedish platform firms, they're very small. As a percentage of the economy, it's minuscule in Sweden. I think platform revenue is equal to that of consumption of pears in Sweden or something like that. Someone said pizza as well, but I think pizza is much more, given my own consumption of the two products. Anecdotal and evidence there. But I know some of these people who own the platforms in Sweden, and to be honest, there are maybe 5-6 people, they're venture capital funded, not very well funded for that matter, and what we want them to do, I mean, our primary objective is for the platform to live up to the existing collective agreements. And I don't think that when they will hire their sixth person, this will be a master programmer slash labor lawyer. It's going to be very hard for them to interpret our collective agreements for them. My union has over 100 collective agreements, or sector-wise. So how do we do this? But at the same time, many platforms in different markets, we don't know which markets will use platforms in the future. How will they solve the problem? So what we propose in Sweden, it's an idea, actually. I'm not allowed to call it a proposal. It's a political decision. It's much more fluffy this way. And it's open for discussion. But what we look at is what these platform needs, and this has also been mentioned earlier, we have industry 4.0, we have platforms 4.0, but we have regulation 1.0. So regulation has to be digitized. So the idea we propose is, in any area where a platform is having a hard time leading up to regulation, because maybe there's additional costs, maybe this agency in particular wants them to send in, you know, printed papers or fax in some cases, which is true in Sweden, maybe there could be a digital standard in place. So instead of, and this is some experiences I have from working for the Swedish Digitalisation Commission, is that we can't really trust each of the 100 or so Swedish government agencies to have a successful standard for platforms to do. So what we propose is you create an institution where you create these standards in the future. So whenever there's a standard needed, the social partners, the platform owners, the unions, and the government sits down and discusses how should a standard for this platform be developed in order to make it as easy as possible for the platform to live up to the regulatory framework. And that means that we are sort of trying to eliminate the regulatory arbitrage by actually making it easier to follow the rules, and then platforms can focus on developing the technical aspects. Because whether we like it or not, platforms might be the future of labor, but it doesn't have to be the platform economy of today. And I actually think the platform economy today is, you know, we looked at e-commerce in 1998 in Sweden in particular. It was a big hype around that. My father bought chinos on a store and it was so cool, but when it came to returns, it didn't really work out. But that bubble burst. But look at e-commerce today. It's a totally different thing. So maybe we're at a very early development right now where these platforms aren't all the hype they're made up to be, but they probably will be in 5-10 years, maybe even faster. We don't know. So that's, I'm trying to sum that up really quickly. It's a long report. It's coming out in English, I should add. So
thank you very much, Frederick. That's a fascinating idea, as you put it, but I wonder whether it would translate beyond the Nordic economies. What do you think, briefly?
Well, the whole self-regulatory regime in Sweden doesn't only rely on the fact that we like to agree with each other, it's that we have union density of 70%. And when push comes to shove, there's always the threat of industrial action. And I think the whole key to success of organizing this is actually organizing workers in the platform economy. And that puts a high pressure on us to actually adapt and try and include them. As a traditional union, which is pretty, well, union isn't that old, but the white-collar movement in Sweden is quite old. We have to include them in our structures, because if we don't, there will be new trade unions who will try and do it for us. and perhaps much will be lost of the progress we have made. Thanks.
Thank you. Very quickly, an anecdote. I spent the summer spending quite a lot of time with Uber Eats drivers in London who were, they were organizing themselves. There were no trade unions involved, but they were very upset that they felt they'd been duped by Uber to sign up to this service. They'd bought their motorcycles. They were cycling around delivering things. One day they woke up and there was an update to the app which said that the fees that they were going to earn had been halved overnight and they had no say over it. And they were organizing themselves in a really interesting way because obviously they don't know who each other is. They're all these diffuse people that are just working with a phone. But a few of them got together and then they opened the app themselves and they started ordering pizzas to their location on the street. And so other Uber Eats drivers would arrive to deliver pizzas to them and they found that they weren't in fact customers, they were people who wanted to get them to join their strike. And that was how the momentum built. And I only tell you this to say that actually sometimes these technologies can be used in very innovative ways and that even when trade unions aren't involved, workers are figuring out how to do this on their own. Right, let's open this up to questions. Does anyone have any questions? We'll take a few at a time, I think. So yes, we'll take the ITUC, and I can't see what the symbol is, but the lady down there, and TCO Sweden to start off with. Thank you.
Firstly, I apologize because I'm going to have to run to catch my train soon, but I wanted to ask Saadia, in the segment from the employer surveys that the WEF did about skill changes, was there any data on the extent to which skills will be more complex and diverse, and the extent to which workers will be de-skilled?
Thank you. I want to say something about, and I have a question about universal basic income and that idea. As we've heard from Valerio, for example, we see technological change. It's changed the organization of work. We will see more of these short casual jobs. Some people will have difficulties supporting themselves on that kind of jobs, and some people, including some trade unionists, draw the conclusion that we need some kind of universal basic income. But I think that actually what we need is more of active labor market policy, because of course we need unemployment insurance for those people. When the spells that you are unemployed, there must be some kind of support. But I think we also need active labor market policies. These people need to be trained to be able to move up the ladder. And I think it was very interesting that the World Economic Forum is going to look at what I think is the relevant question. What are jobs for tomorrow? Which are the jobs that are disappearing? And how do we move people from A to B? I think that is really the key policy issue. And I think this is not wishful thinking. This is actually the 20th century. This is the history of the 20th century in OECD countries. This is a successful history of the 20th century in OECD countries. So I think the idea of universal basic income is actually the idea of giving up on workers. It's the idea that we should actually. My question would be that isn't there a risk then that you lock people into these low incomes because you offer them money without asking that in return they participate, they look for jobs, they participate in training. And the risk, of course, is that they will stay on that. They will not move. They will stay on these short jobs. They will become more dependent on these platforms. Whereas the trade union strategy should, of course, be to move these people sort of up the ladder. Thank you.
This is a question for the trade union panelists that want to answer it. So the question is, do we or do we not have to take account of the diversity of workers? And what would we answer to a freelancer that would affirm very, very firmly that he doesn't want to enter any employment contract? And, is this a legitimate question? Is this a realistic or irrealistic question that would happen? And there's a second question also for the panelists, what are their suggestions, proposals for improving our statistical knowledge about crowd workers?
Thank you. I think we'll take one more and then answer those, and then hopefully we'll have a very quick second round. We'll take yours as well. Thanks.
Thanks very much indeed. We've talked a lot about legal protections for employment of various kinds and all the issues and difficulties there. We've talked a bit about legal protections for pay of various kinds, minimum income, for example, and others. But there's a third kind of legal protection which we haven't really talked about very much, and that's the possibility of having some kind of legal right to training. Now, what form that might take, whether it's paid time off, or the legal right to some kind of financial support in the form of a grant or a loan, or whether it's a legal right to have some kind of access to appropriate skills for retraining or preparatory training, for example, in coding for people who want to kind of join the revolution rather than just be displaced by it. But I just wonder whether the panel might have any thoughts about that third kind of legal protection and whether that's a possible way forward too.
Excellent. Thank you very much. So some great questions there on big themes. Let's just take it in turns and you can answer the questions that you think are most relevant to you. Frederick, do you want to start?
Sure. So as for unions opening up to a diversity of workers, this is the strategy we have chosen. One of our founding unions, the industrial white-collar union in Sweden, SIF, made a decision in 1996 to include self-employed in their statute so we could also organize them. This membership has grown quite considerably over the past 3-4 years. And the reason we chose to do it was that we saw after the 90s financial crisis in Sweden, a lot of people were laid off and returned to their jobs as independent contractors, doing basically the same job they were doing before. So we saw that there was a need to include them under the union umbrella. Now, this kind of gets into like what should the role of a trade union be in 2017? And I mean, collective bargaining services when you are in trouble, all of that is something we have to look at. But what we also expanded more into is insurances. You know, when it comes to being self-employed, there's all different kinds of services you have. How do you deal stress in your work situation, which you control much yourself? How do you negotiate pricing? So, I mean, I think that the policy of my union is that whether you are employed, you are a manager, or you are self-employed, you are at work. You should be a member of your trade union. So it's a much more holistic approach to helping our members solve problems that arise in work. And I think this is we've taken a pretty big step in doing that. So I think self-employed should definitely be included. But what we see with the rise of platforms is that many self-employed will be dependent on platform frameworks. And if that platform becomes a monopoly, like we discussed before, our members will want a say in how that monopoly is rigged. And that means we have to be able to bargain collectively for them. So that is a short answer to a really complicated question.
Sure. So on your first question, Tim, yes, we certainly found out what those different skills groups are going to be, but I think partly what we tried to do is unbundle that by industry, unbundle that by sector, unbundle that by country, because all of this does require a very context-specific approach. I think taking a sort of a sweeping view at this is not actually possible. So a lot of the detail is really in the report. But we did also try to aggregate at sort of the top 10 skills that are important today versus the top 10 skills that will be important in 2020. And frankly, we were not expecting to see any change in that top 10, given that we're just talking about a few years and we're talking about thousands and thousands of data points. We did not expect a change. Surprisingly, we did find one. And so the two skills that drop out of the top 10 are quality control, which is understandable. It can be automated. And the second one is active listening, which I found a little surprising. The two that move in are, again, not surprising at all. I think we've all heard this. One, creativity. The other one, collaboration. And so it's a very sort of almost redundant at this point that these are the areas that will be required. Maybe as a second point, because you asked the question earlier on gender, and it relates a little bit to the lady's question on where there is a matter of choice involved. I think we do need to see some of the positives around the platforms too. One is the set of people that actually want to have that kind of choice. And there is, so far, some of the studies show that there is a gender component to that. There are a number of women who would otherwise have dropped out of the workforce who are finding some of these platforms useful ways of being able to work flexibly. Now, there are some fundamental questions around should all the care burden be on women only, but there are some women who have found that to be an interesting way to transition back afterwards into the regular employment. The second piece around this is when we're talking about platform work, it has very different implications in different parts of the world. I think much of our conversation today and much of the reactions and policy reactions we've been talking about are related to advanced economies. But there are many, many parts of the world where these platforms are offering an earning opportunity, not employment, but they're offering an earning opportunity that otherwise would not have existed. So to give you an example, there's a young woman in Cairo who's created a ride-sharing app which, given the city's huge traffic problems and given the city's huge problems with sexual harassment for women on public transport, could be a game changer, again, for very specific groups of people. But there are a lot of positives. And then, of course, the last piece is we can use the very same technologies that are being used by some of these platforms to also deliver things like adult training and skilling, using exactly the same kinds of platforms. So I think there needs to be some care built into the reactions that are put in place to manage some of the negative externalities of the platforms.
Thank you very much. Very interesting answers. Pascal, do you want to tackle, maybe you could tackle the universal basic income question in particular?
Yes, on universal basic income, indeed, yes. Very quickly, again, in France, this is something that came up as part of a report coming from the National Council for the for Digitalisation. It was a stock-taking exercise for the Uber workers, and it was really the consequence of the fact that people had realized that you can't actually make a living if you only have this as your only source of income. If it's additional income, why not? But if you try to make a living out of being a Uber driver, I mean, 70 hours a week for 900 euros, I mean, without any contribution for your pension, etc., it's not sustainable. So this is what it was, what it came from. We're very much against it at Force Ouvrière. We're very much against any logic of universal basic income because it would institutionalize and justify this new economy of poor workers and dependent workers. That's the first thing I'd like to say. Second thing is that in France, the only way of financing universal basic income is to either have put an end to social help assistance or put an end to social security as we know it. That would mean that the universal basic income would cancel the unemployment benefits and put an end to pensions. In other words, you'd be saying if you give to anyone over 18 in France, say, 800 euros a month, which is quite a lot of money when you think about it, then it means that's all they get from the government. I'm sorry, I'll be very blunt, but it means you're giving to every single French person 800 euros, but then you have to cope for yourself. That's it. And if you want to contribute towards a private insurance with those 800-900 euros, well, please do it. If you don't want to, just don't do it. But there is no collective. There's nothing, no national pension scheme, for instance. You are on your own, and with your Uber drivers, you try to work 70 hours a week, and then you might be making 1,000 euros at the end of the day. And in order to cope, then you are given 600 or 700 euros. That's it, full stop. And then it's the jungle. I mean, you all try to survive and cope, and you try to walk, and you have to compete with your neighbor, etc. No. So that's the approach, and that's the problem, is the total individualization of the system, and it's breaking down, I mean, and killing our old system. I could talk about that for hours, but I mean, I would just say that if you take the example of Alaska, Alaska at the beginning set up a universal basic income at $300. five years down the road, I think, they put it down to 80, okay, 80. And so what you had at the beginning from the government, then usually it goes down a couple of years down the road. And it doesn't mean that they are creating more social security because they broke so much from the outset anyway, giving these 300 euros. So we're very much against it. I think you got that.
Very clear. Thank you. I didn't know about the Alaskan example. Jan, do you want to chip in?
Yeah. I want to address this question, what if they all want to be freelancers? But before that, briefly on statistical knowledge. Yes, there's much still to learn about that phenomenon, but I'm quite optimistic. I know that you guys in Frankfurt will do a lot, gather a lot of data. There's also plans for offline surveys in a number of West European countries that will focus on platform work. And at ETUI, we also plan this work this year, actually, to do some offline surveys surveys in Eastern Europe where no one wants to actually pay for these countries, so we will do that. There should be quite a lot of, sort of evidence in the next year or two. Now, what if they want all to be freelancers? And indeed, I think it's true. If you, for instance, I know delivery drivers or bicycles, I don't know if these are drivers, people who ride bicycles for delivery in Brussels. If you ask them, well, do you want to be employees or do you want to organize in some sort of institution, they say, well, no, because we are students, I'm doing it for a couple of summers or for a while when studying, and then I want to move to something better. So, and I don't want to invest into organizing, and I don't want to be employed. I want that flexibility. But then, if you ask them what they want, they actually want many properties that comes or many features that come with some sort of employment relationship. So they want some sort of minimum compensation. They want some work time regulation, and they want insurance. So that's quite obvious. But they don't think so much about pensions. But if you ride bicycle in Brussels or in another city, it's quite a dangerous thing to do. And these people get injured, and it's important for them to have insurance. And in Brussels, I was able to actually get a deal for the delivery drivers that, or these bicycle people, that they, if they want, they can with delivery. They have a guarantee of working for 3 hours. They have some insurance. Delivery also pays for some contributes to this sort of cost of bicycle and the like. And I think the broader point there is that many of these models or these platforms are compatible with these provisions. And they can operate with them. And actually, we often hear how efficient these matching mechanisms are. But if you look at the many of these platforms, how they match skills or workers with task or work, it's not very efficient because they don't have no incentives to actually think about the efficiency of allocation because they can shift the risks on the workers. So often, the complaints we hear from the workers, and also that's the ILO research that you did, they complain about the lack of work on the platform, and also they complain about long sort of search for work and having to sort of reject work which is not relevant for them. So, by implementing these provisions like work time regulation or minimum pay, be it sort of Scandinavian style of the negotiated or other forms of provision, actually also what sort of provide incentives for making these matching mechanisms actually efficient also for in terms of the matching of skills to tasks.
Thank you, Jan. Six, do you want to chip in? And I think one of the questions we haven't addressed directly yet is, should there be some sort of right to education or right to skills training?
I don't know about a right. I'm not a lawyer, but I know that Unionen does a lot of has a lot of offers for self-employed members in terms of discounts for education. So I don't know the direct answer to that question, but I know that training is something that interests union members, white collar union members, and freelance white collar union members. I guess I'll use that as sort of a segue to reiterate Jan's answer to Odile's questions. So in Germany, Verdi has been organizing self-employed workers for a long time, and IG Metall, I guess a year and a half ago now, said, okay, we'll allow freelancers or self-employed persons to become members. So we don't require that people say, oh, I want to go to court and say that I'm
misclassified. It's okay to want to be a freelancer and appreciate the flexibility that that affords, but a lot of people who say, yeah, I like being a freelancer, still say, oh, I wish I had more pay, or I wish I had more work, or I wish I had a way to convince the platform operators to listen to my concerns, and they're not listening. When I send an email, I can send 10 emails and I get nothing back, or I get, thank you for your email, you know? And so, you know, even people who enjoy or need to be freelancers, they still want to have access to social protection and a voice in their digital workplace. I had a couple more comments. To the question of how do we improve our statistical knowledge, we can have discussions bilaterally if you're really interested in the details. But in addition to the answer of there's a lot of stuff going on, I know Eurofound is thinking about doing some additions to the working conditions survey. Maybe they're going to do some targeted work. I know your colleagues at the ILO are doing a lot of empirical work on many different platforms right now. We're doing some smaller surveys in order to build a database for the next version of our website on 10 different platforms. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff going on, and we can talk about, I mean, our method has been, in order to recruit workers, is that we go through the platforms. For the in-person work, you can stop delivery bicyclists on the street and say, hey, do you have 10 minutes? I'll give you 10 euro in your hand right now if you answer this survey. And if they say, no, I'm too busy, then you give them a card with a URL on it and say, go to this URL when you are bored at home, and you get 10 euros over PayPal or whatever. Right. So there's pretty simple ways of doing it. I wanted to address briefly the question of the sort of gender diversity access / developing economy sort of positives of this. And I think that that's something that we as European labor organizations are going to have to really confront or grapple with, this sort of global justice angle, right? So if you have work that can be crowdsourced to a platform that can be completed by anyone in the world, maybe for 6 euro an hour to somebody in Germany, that's below minimum wage, that's horrible, and we should all get out on the street waving our red flags and say this should be abolished. And for somebody who is living in a country where the cost of living is 1/4 that in Germany, they see that and they say, that's fantastic, I'm so happy that I'm able to have access to this work. And if we say, you know, this should be abolished, then we're not contributing to any sort of cause of global justice, and we're not gonna earn ourselves any friends. We're just trying to kind of build an invisible wall in the virtual world. And that's, I don't think that's something that we get behind politically either. The last thing is connected to this, but it's a bit of a meta comment, which is that a colleague of mine and I noticed that the program today in particular, had a maximum of 2 women on each panel, 1 if you don't count the moderator. And I think everyone in the room would be able to volunteer that their affiliate organizations for OECD would be willing to support any efforts by the OECD staff to improve the gender representation in future events.
Well said. I'm afraid we're very short on time, and so I don't think we'll be able to take your questions. But we will sum up if every person on this panel can just say very briefly their one best idea that could be started to be worked on now to tackle these issues of platform work. And we will finish there. Valerio, do you want to start?
And this also is linked to the first question on one of the questions on should we allow people to be freelancers? Of course, we should allow people to be freelancers, provided that they are all given fundamental rights and access to fundamental rights, and that's one. And two, they really work as freelancers, because you are not allowed to work as a freelancer and to be classified as a freelancer if you are working as an employee, as you're not allowed to accept a job, a wage for below the minimum wage. There are some mandatory rules on the labor market that create a level playing field. So the answer to the question of freelancer is, of course, provided that the rules are complied with.
Let's talk to workers over the platforms. Let's talk to workers who are working on platforms. Let's use technology, but let's also think about how we can use technology in coordination and in support of established trade union strategies and ways of building a sort of sense of collective awareness among workers. Because there's definitely, workers are aware in some cases that they're not getting a good deal, and they are aware that maybe there might be some ways for them to get a better deal, and by and large, they are not yet talking to our organizations.
I think I will reiterate some of the points that Valerio has made. I think it's important, the point that the platform economy, it covers various forms of precarious work often, and we need different sort of solutions to address each of them, and there's no one size-fits-all solution. I don't think we need a new category of protection. I think it's dangerous, would be dangerous for reasons we discussed, but what we need on the European level, I think, is to get rid of the possible restrictions on covering platform workers or self-employed through collective bargaining that we have at the moment. And what we also, I think, would be useful to have a set of fundamental principles of sort of protection rights for workers that will apply to, that have to apply to all workers, regardless of their status, being a self-employed or employees.
Quel que soit son statut.
Now, whatever your status, whether you're independent or employed, an employee, I mean, we need to defend and protect collective rights, and we need to unionize.
A couple of things in particular to focus on. As I mentioned, some of this adult skilling related work. We're actually working on an initiative to get the IT industry itself to be one of the solution providers and to become part of a new initiative on a new deal for lifelong learning. So we'll keep you posted on that as that work emerges. And the second piece is, of course, the technology is fundamentally neutral. It's the designers behind it that make the ethical choices that then lead to certain types of and of course, afterwards, the business model. And so part of what we're also going to do is look at what are some of the ethics that go behind some of these platforms, that go behind some of also the artificial intelligence and some of the other new technologies that are coming up. And we're going to be exploring that at the forum's new policy center in San Francisco on the responses to the fourth industrial revolution. So we'll also keep you posted on that as that work progresses.
And I think I will try and look at the regulatory perspective. I mean, platforms should follow the rules that we have set up. They should not get a competitive advantage from cheating. That's not the way the market economy is supposed to work. However, one piece of legislation, or one several piece of legislation, which needs to be overlooked is competition policy. It's not designed for platform-based labor markets, newspaper markets. There seems to be something inherently skewed in bargaining power when we get to online platforms in any sort, and this needs to be considered and revised in competition policy.
Perfect. I'm going to end it there and just ask you to say thank you to the panelists. I think that was absolutely fascinating. And I'll hand over to John Evans. Thank you very much.